From the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you all good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever the case may be in your time zone, all 25 of them. There are so many arguments about that. Some even say 26. I don't know. I'm old-fashioned. 24 is what I remember. But whatever. All of you out there, welcome to Midnight in the Desert. My name is Art Bell. The rules of this program are as follows. First of all, Friday night, open line. So, no bad language. Only one call per show. And, of course, the two-drink maximum. Now, I know that in past weeks, people have begun to get that confused with a minimum. But, no, it's drink max. I want to thank a group of people. Joe Talbot at Telos for the great sound. Thank you, buddy. Keith, my webmaster of forever. Heather Wade, my producer who can get it on. If you have a guest or you have somebody you want to get on the show, interview a producer at artbell.com. Stream guys, LV.net, they get it from here to there. Sales, Pete Eberhardt, TuneIn Radio, forever our pals. News with Amy Martin. And, of course, my wife, Erin and Asia, for putting up with my weird hours. It's not easy. Okay, so tonight I wanted to do a commercial for our time traveler service. I haven't done that in a long time. I've almost never done it, actually. So I thought I'd try a different approach. So put this in your mind. Earlier tonight, my 8-year-old daughter Asia came to me and said, "Daddy, can I get a lunchbox with a picture of a little kitten on it?" And I looked over at my wife, and she looked at me like, "Well, how about it?" I said, "No, girls, I'm sorry. Sorry, Asia. Not enough people joined the time travelers. No lunchbox with a kitten for you." And her eyes grew big. A tear formed in the corner, then rolled down her cheek. She said, "Daddy, you got to do better." Anyway, that's my pitch. The real deal is this. did I have your heart going? Probably not, huh? So, becoming a time traveler involves being able to hear past shows, all the past shows. Really cool. And you can have them when you want them, you know, middle of the day when you're on a car drive, whatever. And it involves being able to use what we call, affectionately, the wormhole. We're careful with that name. You send a message in down where Keith is. It ends up coming out here on this end, and frequently I read them on the air, use them with guests, whatever. No guests tonight, just open lines. Brussels, Belgium is virtually shut down. The whole area is a result of everything going on, and we'll touch on what everything is briefly only. They've shut it down. They've told people, look, stay home. It's that serious. It's a level 4 whatever. Stay home. Don't get anywhere near crowds. Something's going to happen. They've never been at that level before. And before I could get to sleep last night, I saw the breaking news of the attack on the hotel in Malian capital. Mali State TV says the government has declared a 10-day state of emergency beginning at midnight. About 3 guys with AKs went in and hit the Radisson Blue Hotel there. One American, I now understand, is dead from that. It's everywhere. This is like a virus, this whole terrorist thing. I think they're competing with each other to see who can kill more, Al-Qaeda or ISIS. We kill more, join us. Sheesh. Then there is a not good idea. Republican presidential rivals rushed on Friday to smear Donald Trump and any support he might have for his calling for the U.S. to have a database tracking Muslims in the United States. Probably unconstitutional anyway, so not a good idea. But it sounds like a Trump thing. Now, here's a really good idea that should have already been in place. People on the U.S. government's terrorist watch list often can't board commercial airliners, right? They're on a no-fly list. But they're on an okay gun list. In other words, even if you're on a no-fly list because they think you're a terrorist, or maybe, you can still walk into a gun store and legally buy pistols, powerful military-style rifles. And it just seems to me, and I would think would seem to you too, that, you know, if you're not allowed to fly because the government perceives you're a terrorist, then probably you shouldn't be able to buy a gun either. But, you know, we live in a politically correct world, right? Oh, you've got to go to my website, artbell.com. I obviously don't go there frequently enough myself because there's this really cool story. I'm sorry, but I love it. It's called Bizarre Cases of People Who Spontaneously Cease to Exist. Would I kid you about something like this? No. And it's really got a visual that is so cool. It shows a guy walking down, there's a movie called The Road, right? For those of you who saw that, it looks like he's walking down the road, as in the movie. And as he's walking, he is pixelating away. Most of his upper leg and part of his torso are already gone. But this story is not a joke, actually. They're talking about people who spontaneously, sometimes in front of other people, simply cease to exist. They're never heard from again. They're never found. They never send postcards. Maybe they're gone. A glitch, perhaps, in the Matrix? I don't know. But this story is for real. And if you want to read it, be my guest. At least catch the visual. It's really amazing. Just a few seconds, I guess, and you're gone. Never to be heard from again. Where do you go? Does this really happen? How many people nationwide disappear, and I mean never to be seen again, in Walmart restrooms? I'll just leave that one on the table for you to think about. So, okay, open lines. As I said, and anything goes, coming up in just a second. So you're welcome to get on the lines ahead of time. You already have done that. They're full. I will open a special line tonight. I wasn't going to do it, but I was tempted into it, by the way, by somebody in our wormhole. Now, just to prove to you that I do read the messages, let me get it up here and take a look. Let's see. It's a cool way to send messages to me. It is Clay who writes, Art, I'd love to hear some shows on prepping. Well, it's open lines tonight, Clay. We're not going to really do a prepping show, but I would like to open a prepper's line. And here's my idea. If you're a prepper, I'd like a call from you. And when you do call, I would like to know what you're prepping for. In other words, what are you stocking up for? What are you preparing for? What do you think is going to happen that causes you to go buy extra stuff at Walmart before you go to the restroom to disappear? So if you are a prepper who would like to discuss prepperism, you can call us at area code 575-208-7787. I'm trying to do these slowly. You ready? Prepper line. Area code 575-208-7787. The first time caller line. Yes, tonight we will operate at area code 775-285-5800. 775-285-5800. Hey, Obama has made a statement on UFOs. I didn't know that. This comes from anomalous.com. The president has made some remarks in interviews over the years or a step beyond no comment. The president said that UFOs are not as top secret as you might think. Now, what do you think that means? Not as top secret as you might think. Now, that could mean that they are out there. They're in our skies, and we know it. Or it could mean there's no secrecy attached to these things because they're not real. What do you think? It's hard to tell with our president, huh? I don't know. I wasn't very hopeful, really, that this particular president was going to tell us the story. You know, take office, demand immediate information, right? And tell the world what it's really all about. But remember, open lines night, anything goes. You don't have to talk about prepping. Although I hope some will, because I really want to know why you're doing it. And then, who do you wish would spontaneously disappear? I really shouldn't ask that, should I? You've got to read that story, artbell.com. Go up there and do it. Really good stuff. Spontaneously disappearing, pixeling out, as it were. Actually, it looks more like little pieces of them breaking off, you know, but you get the idea. Okay, I think we're about ready. Let me, I suppose, take a fast break and gather my senses before we open the gates of... Well, we'll talk about what the gates let in, I guess, toward the end of the program tonight. One never knows. This is Midnight in the Desert. I'm Art Bell.
Doesn't screen calls. We trust you, but remember, the NSA, well, you know. To call the show, please dial 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Well, okay, here we go. Casting our lot into the night. Just one quick comment. Well, actually, two, I'm sorry. One is, so now there's a big fight going on here in the U.S. about whether or not to let these people in, right? And, you know, the president's on one side saying, come on, it's women and children. And the governors and Congress on the other side saying, And I understand, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free, the refuse, you know, on and on. Well, yeah, but nothing in there about give me your AK-47 favoring, you know, extremists. So, you know, the world's in a mess right now, and I guess we've got to be careful, but we've got to be careful about who we are, too. We are America. And we have generally allowed people to come in who really, really need a place to go to. The problem is they really are infiltrating in that way. So I fully, fully understand the caution. All right, here comes the talk. And then I promise we're really away. Here's the way to get in if you want to talk to us. Public number, area code 952-225-5278. Or think of it as area code 952, call Arch. Pretty cool number, huh? Took a little work to get that. Area code 952, call Art. And we've got a special line for you tonight. If you are a prepper, we would like to know how long you've been prepping, what you're prepping for, and what, well, in other words, what you think is coming, right? That number would be area code 575-208-7787. And then finally, first-time callers at area code 775-285-5800. And then finally, sorry, the Skype talk. We really love Skype because when it's right, when it sounds right, you sound really good. And I'm going to tell you how to sound really good. If you've got an iPhone or if you've got an Android or even a tablet, if you know where the little pinhole is for the mic, you can download Skype free of charge. Free of charge. Doesn't get any better than that, right? And it delivers really good audio. So when you get Skype, download it, then put us in. If you're in North America, America or Canada, put in MITD 51, MITD 51. If you're outside the rest of the world, put in MITD 55. Little plus sign, add contact, MITD 55 outside the country. And then there are additional rules for that. Do not use a Bluetooth because they sound bleh. And do not use a speakerphone because they too sound bleh. If you talk right into the phone, you're going to have a very commanding voice. And what you have to say here on the show is going to grab people's attention, you know, as Ross would with his voice, right? And that's what you want to do. You want to get your point across. Make a point. Dave, make a point. Hello. Dave.
Hi, Dave. Hello, Art.
Yes, hello, Dave.
Yes, I was, you caught me unexpected.
Well, when you get through and you hear the audio on Skype, it means you're coming up, so better get ready.
Very good. You've had all sorts of people on your show, but maybe you haven't had one of me.
Okay, I will consider that. Why should I have you? You know, you mean as a guest, like a guest.
Even just as someone that you're talking. I'm a Scientologist.
Really?
Yes.
Isn't there a new antibiotic for that?
Say again?
Nothing. Go ahead.
We have it all, the past lives, the body, out-of-body experiences, all that stuff, which is stuff you cover on your show. Not so much UFOs, but I have some comments on them if you want. I'm willing to talk a little bit of shop on all this stuff. So as they say, want to take a ride?
Well, not a Scientologist ride, really, but I mean, I wouldn't bar you from talking about it.
Sure. Specifically, there's an awful lot that you've talked about that is stuff that we cover as far as that goes, like the hypnotist that you talked about that you had on a couple weeks ago that talked about past lives and so on.
Yes.
The little tricks that he used sounds like it's straight out of Dianetics and other related books as far as that goes.
Yeah, but why would you want tricks used on you?
I'm saying the tricks and stuff that he used.
Oh, he used, yeah.
Yeah, yes.
Well, similar, though, to Dianetics, you said.
Yeah, they're very similar to that. Mm-hmm. I do have a couple small critiques, though. For example, you had asked him, how do you know if the guy is faking it or not?
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
And the thing that he said that he used his own ability, a spiritual ability, to verify that someone was actually looking at something versus making it up.
Yeah, I prefer another mode. What you do
yeah,
is you,
exactly.
you tell the person you've got hypnotized that they can't feel anything in their leg, and then you start at them with a sewing needle. And pretty quickly you're going to know if they're really under or not.
Well, the thing is that even if you grant him the credibility that, yeah, he could do that,
the thing is
the ability to have that kind of perception is pretty rare as far as that goes. And you would basically want a system that anyone could use as far as that goes. And it's a similar type of technique, but you're working with the idea of you want people to more consciously be aware of it as far as that goes, instead of going into a hypnotic trance as far as that goes. The other thing that he did
you
not,
say that a lot as far as that goes.
Well, I can go into a lot of detail, but I don't want to get super technical.
No. Very broad brushes, please.
Yes. One thing that he did not use is a thing called, you could call it a canceller. That is a command that says, when you start off at the beginning of session, when I'm done with all the stuff we're talking about, any suggestions that I may have made to you accidentally during the course of our discussion are canceled. He doesn't use that. And that is kind of a critique, and that's a thing that is in Dianetics.
All right, well, listen, we're way short on time, and, you know, callers can only get so much time, so rather than have the entire Dianetics thing unveiled in front of us tonight, I think we'll move on for now and say hello. You're on the air.
Hey, all right, let me turn off the headset real quick here.
Oh, good. Yes, do that.
Please bear with me. I'd like to comment about the Walmart thing. Let me turn this on Bluetooth.
You okay, sir?
I believe that there is such a shortage of prisons in our country, and if there ever is mass panic, the Walmart stores, like, you know, there's 4,400 Walmart locations, plus their distribution centers, which are strategically located across the country, would make ideal prisons for mass incarceration if there is mass panic. In Greece, the banks were shut down for about 3 weeks, and they started looting the stores.
You mean to tell me that you think, oh my God, that Walmarts would be used as prison centers?
Well, they have the trucks. They have all the trucks. They have all the equipment. They have the cooling centers. They have all kinds of stuff. And if one thing is kind of interesting, before I'd like to really talk.
By the way, do you have any comment on people just spontaneously disappearing in their restrooms?
Well, kind of, sort of. If you Walmart spelled backwards is Tramwa. And there's a lot of mumbo jumbo stuff about tram law on the internet. But if somebody Googles tram law and looks that up, there's a lot of people that have a lot to say about Walmart.
Really?
I shopped at Walmart yesterday. You know, I love the good prices. I used to think that, you know, they put mom and pops out of business, but if people could afford to buy food for their family at Walmart, you know, so be it. But and also, I'd really like to touch on baseball, because a lot of people say, you know, I'm mostly white. It wasn't me that did slavery. It wasn't me that killed the Native Americans. It was my ancestors. And, you know, darn right it was our ancestors. We're a young country.
But you carry genetic shame because of it, sir.
Well, I don't think genetic shame. No, we're a young country, Art, and I believe that these people, you know, they saw and they heard what we did to the people in Nigeria. And also to the Native Americans in this country, what we've done to the land, you know, in Australia, New Zealand, South America, on and on and on and on. And it's just to me, it's a hop, skip, and a jump. Some people said that chaos creates change.
Your genes are hanging their little chins on their chests.
Well, I think the chemtrails do a good job with that. But at any rate, I just like to add really quickly, you know, 90 million buffalo later.
Yes.
You know, we were the white. It was called Manifest Destiny.
You know, I miss the buffalo, sir, now that you've mentioned it. I really miss them.
Yeah, well, I guess Ted Turner has that going on up there. I don't know what else he's doing to CNN. I think maybe Ted Turner should sell some free spots to President Obama to tell us about chemtrails or something.
You don't own CNN anymore.
Oh, I didn't know that. I just like to touch on the tram law thing, Art, and just please keep up the good work. I don't think people have any idea what kind of mental capacity Art Bell has to do what he does. I just like to thank you once again.
Well, thank you again, and have a good night. And concentrate on that disappearance that we talked about. And for goodness sakes, check out this thing about people disappearing generally, just sort of blinking out, as it were. All right, where to go, where to go? Let's see. Let's go to Ryan. I think it's going to be Ryan calling in on Skype. Yo, Ryan.
Hey. Hey, Art. Long-time listener. Can you hear me fine?
I hear you, sure.
Wonderful. Ryan in Washington State, by the way. I'm getting your signal good up here.
Good.
But before you went off the air on Sirius...
Yes.
You had an interesting show with Dr. Roger Lear, and I wanted to see if you can comment about, first of all,
I'll tell you
passing.
What, sir, I'll tell you what, we're at a break. I'm going to ask you to hold over, and I'll bring you right back, okay?
Sounds good.
All right, good.
You could read my mind, love, what a tale my thoughts could tell. Just like an old-time movie about a ghost from a wishing well. In a castle dark.
Midnight sweeps across America. You've found an oasis for the mind. To call Midnight in the Desert, please dial 1-952-CALL-ART. That's 1-952-225-5278.
And you know the Skype gateways, right? So away we go. Back to Skype, in fact. And Ryan, who was on the air when the break came, nothing I can do about it. Ryan, I'm sorry. You're back on the air.
That's radio, Art.
It is, yes.
Anyways, back when Roger Lear was on your show back with Sirius, it was kind of hectic at that time.
John Lear, you mean John Lear, right?
Roger Lear.
Roger Lear.
Roger
Dr. Roger Lear?
Right.
Yes, he's passed away, you know.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
But at the time, it was pretty hectic when you were over there, and didn't have much time for follow-up, and I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about Roger Lear and some of the things that he discussed on that show. Some of the things that he discussed on that show included a really incredible UFO sighting that he had shortly before he passed. And
rather than me trying to reconstruct that show... you know, those were copied by the pirates. Every single one of them went up there. So you can find that and listen to it yourself.
Right, right. But I talked to him shortly before he passed, and there was quite a few UFOs seen when he was over there. But I just wanted to see if you could... you know, it's sort of sad to see somebody like that gone because he's...
Very sad, and I don't know of anybody on the horizon to replace him. He, you know, he removed things from people, and I don't know of any other doctor doing that right now. I'm not saying there isn't somebody, but if there's an implant and you want it out, I'm not, you know, I don't know who to send you to now. So he's right about that. Dr. Lear is a tremendous loss. Who else is out there removing implants and treating them the right way? In other words, if it's really an implant, let's think about this. The average doctor is going to throw it in, you know, in the trash, bio trash, and nobody's ever going to look at it. Let's go to our prepper line, dip our hand in, see what we get. Hello.
Hi, I guess you could say I've been kind of inadvertently a prepper since I was a little kid, but I've gotten it more focused recently. But really quickly, if I can make a quick comment before I go into that.
What is that? Wait a minute. I do want to go into that. I don't understand what an inadvertent prepper is. Is that like those people you see on TV that get buried by their possessions in their house?
No, more kind of the opposite. I was raised, kind of off the land almost, raised like out of a tent or out of a camper, most of my life, and pretty much lived off the land for little segments of my childhood, sometimes hardly eating anything from the store, but mostly just plants where I live.
Almost feral. What am I hearing in the background?
Oh, I'm sorry. That's my doves. I can go in the background to quiet that. I mean,
those are doves. Really, I just wanted to know they're doves.
Yeah.
Now I know what it sounds like when doves cry.
They're just doing their usual singing. I don't know if this is any better. I have crickets in the back room.
If they made that sound around me, it'd be more like what doves do when they die. Anyway, go ahead. I sidetracked you.
In living off the land, I learned to learn what plants in the area were edible and what plants were used for what purposes.
Right.
And just basic things like how to get water, make water traps and find shelter and stuff like that, and be able to take long hikes in the desert.
Your mom and dad really had you making water traps?
Not so much that, but they were making, they made some water, alternative water situations.
Uh-huh. Well, water is the first thing anybody would need, no question about that. Okay, so anyway, you're a prepper.
As I got older, I studied the things like the water traps and making, finding various food, shelter, all that sort of thing.
Sure.
More recently, one thing that going through the desert on a long hike teaches you really quickly is don't pack your bag too heavy.
Mm.
And that is one thing I've brought through the prepping, any
okay.
official prepping I've
what,
done.
But
is
what I would
I
like to know, if you don't mind, what is it that you think you're prepping for?
Mainly social collapse type situations where you won't be able to be at home. You will have to live off the land.
Okay, so you've got a lot of guns, I'm sure, right?
No, actually, that's what I'm not doing is stockpiling a bunch of stuff, because if you have to run for the hills, if you have to make a quick escape, you don't want a bag that's going to be heavier than you are, that's going to weigh you down so fast that if something's chasing you, you don't have a chance.
But you've got some guns, right?
Actually, I have a kid, so I haven't kept guns in the house, but I do have a couple slingshots in there for hunting purposes.
Well, I hate to flash back to the show the other night, but I watched The Walking Dead. And the people who are out just wandering around and don't have guns, well, except for the one lady with the sword, they die real quickly.
But the key is don't be a fighter, be a hider. Be able to hide enough that you aren't going to be found by the people that have the guns. The thing is, I figure if you can survive the first 2 weeks, you have it made, because most people have such little survival knowledge that you're going to be pretty much alone after that first 2 weeks.
Gotcha. Yeah, all right. Well, thank you very much for the call, and that's probably sage advice. I'm probably one of those people, despite what I have, and I do have some, stuff, right, ready. I have stuff, but still in all, I'm not a survivor of Mad Max, if that's what's coming, nor do I know if I wish to be. What about you? I guess stand there like nuclear war and just be the first to go. Don't go by the slow, torturous radiation way. Let's go to Glenn, I think it is. Hello.
Yes, good morning, Art. Hi.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out how I want to fulfill the two curse word minimum. I'm not quite sure how I'll do that, but something will pop to mind.
Okay, what are you calling me on?
I'm on Skype on a HP laptop.
Okay. Does your laptop have a little hole in it where you would have to talk to sound close?
Am I not close? Am I not loud enough?
Better. That's way better.
Oh, I'm leaning in a bit. Okay. What's funny is this is my larger home laptop that I use at home, but apparently the smaller one that I take to work with me actually works better.
Well, what they should do on laptops is they should put a little arrow to microphone. You know, they don't show you where it is, and that's very thoughtless of them. And I mean all of them. There's nothing. Not one of them has little arrow says, okay, Mike is here. And so people don't know where they are on a laptop.
PC mics used to be horrible. I got, until they came out with some really good, the USB ones. Oh, my goodness, the mics were terrible.
Yes.
But anyway, on the prepping front, one of my oldest prepping items is your original C-Crane crank radio that I saw in the original box. I'm sure you've heard this before.
No joke. Right. I've heard it. I've got them. And you're right. That's a big item.
Yeah, the one with the fold-out crank.
Oh, yeah.
And I even got the one with the light upgrade with a special socket drilled in it and a little red light, the red plastic, you know, housing light with a cord on it and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man. That's been there for a long time.
You know what they had to make? They should have a couple little terminals on the side of the crank radio so mm-hmm. that if you capture somebody and need to get information from them, you mm-hmm. simply wire to those two terminals and then two spots on their body, crank for about half an hour, push the button, and they tell you anything you want to hear.
Right, right. I think I bought that radio when cell phones were still analog. You could cut the cord you could tap into the cord that goes to the light and kind of like clothespin the electrodes to their nostrils or something.
Okay. So anyway, you are a prepper, right?
To some degree. I want to be able to stay home for 3 days, a week or two, you know, if absolutely necessary.
All right. Is the number one thing you think people need to prep for? Possibility of.
Well, basically, I think societal disruption. Like, okay, look at what's going on in Brussels, Belgium. Some huge debilitating thing that scares the tar out of people, or that has the government saying stay home, don't go out, and all that, you know, that kind of thing. Just some, I have no illusions of staying alive, you know, forever. If there's a nuclear bomb going to be dropped, I want to go down mm-hmm. on one knee and signal for a fair catch, you know.
Like that.
Yeah, exactly.
For a fair catch.
I got it. It's fine.
You guys are all right. Okay. I guess that makes sense.
I am a believer in God, so I do believe at some point, you know, the Messiah, Jesus, is going to come back. Uh-huh. But there's a lot of bad stuff, I think, that has to happen before then. Don't figure I'll probably be living on this planet for another 15 years. You know. I could be.
I frequently surprise myself, you know. Every day I wake up and I go, really, again?
Well, no, I just sort of trust God with everything. And you know what? I'm a caregiver by trade, by profession. And so I figure, you know, I'm going to end up, you know, I'm just going to, well, you know, I'm not going to just worry about covering my own posterior. You know, I'm probably going to be with other people who are suffering or something if, you know.
It's always good to cover your own posterior and therefore you prep. All right. Well, thank you very much for the call. That was a good one. That actually was a very, very good one. You know, nuclear, global thermonuclear warfare parlance, signaling for a fair catch has some pretty good fair amount of humor. Let's go to first time caller line. You're on the air. Hello.
Oh, well, this is Mr. Smith, I suppose I should say, in Portland, Oregon. You were mentioning earlier in the program about people just disappearing into thin air before your eyes.
Yeah, we've got an article about it on artbell.com.
Oh, really? I haven't read that. But I remember the MH370 thing.
Yes.
The Indonesian Airlines disappeared into thin air, literally into thin air.
It did.
Okay. Now, I saw some stuff on the Internet, and it looked very, very convincing to me. Two different angles. One looked to be taken from a satellite, and one was taken from allegedly a predator drone, mm-hmm. military predator drone.
Mm-hmm.
And the plane was going along. It looked like it took some evasive action in order not to collide with something because it took a sharp left turn, I think, and it flown, it kept flying on, and the satellite view showed that there was a bright flash of light. But before that, three different orbs, orb-like UFOs, came and started circling. I'm talking circling the aircraft from left to right, not in front of it or behind it, but around the middle of the aircraft. And they all got into lockstep with each other, these three.
Yes.
And they were circling around. I don't know if you've seen it or not. Have you?
This is new to me, John. So.
Oh, no. I actually got a, I posted a comment about it on one of your lines, I think, on the internet somehow. I can't remember if it was the mid. I think it was before the Midnight in the Desert.
Okay.
Program.
All time flies.
It disappeared in the thin air.
Mm-hmm.
Just a flash of light, and then you could see that the.
I don't suppose you have any photographs.
I can send it to you if you want me to.
Oh, well, heck yeah!
I made a copy of it.
Well then, heck yeah!
Tell me where to send it to, Art.
Okay, so I am Art Bell at KNYE.com. That's. Don't get dyslexic. Okay. Everybody does. It's Kilowatt Nancy Yokohama Easy. Art Bell at KNYE.com.
Right. Okay, and that was very strange. Very strange, as you'll see when I send it to you. I mean, it was bizarre.
All right, well, if it's strange enough, I'll put it up for everybody.
Well, you're the doctor of the strange, so.
Hmm.
Oh, you were mentioning about the buffalo. You missed the buffalo. I lived in Alaska. Some years ago, and they still have free-range buffalo in Alaska. Several large herds of them. They just let them roam free up there because there's so few fences. You know what I'm saying?
But no longer can you sit out in the wild in Wyoming, contemplating the universe, and sort of with maybe a blade of grass in your mouth, and in the distance you begin to hear this. Well, what can I call them? Giant thundering hooves attached to several thousand pound animals with a cloud of dust coming up on the horizon, and you don't even have time to signal for a fair catch. Going to the phone. Hello there. Hello? No, they gave up. Or chickened out. On my special line, Prepper's Line, you're on the air.
Yes, I'm a recovering Y2K prepper.
Oh. how much stock did you have for Y2K?
Well, I've been a long-time listener to you guys, and I love your program. I bought the year's supply that you were promoting at the time.
Excellent.
And, actually, I've kind of dipped into that lately, and that stuff is still good.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Be good for a long time. Listen, we were not officially connecting a food supply with Y2K, and I want to add, before anybody calls up and says, wow, what a hooks, man. Y2K was such a hooks. No. The fact that everybody screamed and yelled about it is what got programmers to fix it so that the world didn't go to berserk. And so what do? They say, oh, it was a big hoax.
My brother was a programmer, and he advised me to prepare.
Of course.
And I just figured, you know, it's better to have it and not need it than need it and not have it.
But you're still prepping?
No. Matter of fact, I've still got so much left of that that I purchased before. You know, I don't need anything else. I figure I'm ready for anything right now. I mean, I've been into the. I opened up a number 10 can of that milk, and put it in the blender with some good water.
Right.
And it's just like milk. It's,
mm-hmm.
it's great stuff. I just figure, you know,
look,
you should be ready for anything. I mean, like EMP or
if you needed
solar
it,
flares,
if
anything.
You needed it, nothing else would do.
Absolutely. I mean, you have to have water. I mean, I live here in the desert. I live in Vegas, And, you know, you got to have water. And even if you've got food, you still got to have water.
Water would be the first thing you need, actually.
Oh, yeah.
What do you think what do you think of the possibility of Las Vegas? I mean, it really freaks me out that they're digging this deeper straw over there at Lake Mead so you guys can keep drinking water. That's worrisome.
Well, actually, they say that we're, you know, well within our allotment as far as the water goes, but, you know, that's the official...
Yeah. Chamber of Commerce stuff,
but,
right?
Yeah, absolutely. But I don't know. I just think it's better to be prepared than not. And, you know, I was so devastated when you left back in, you know, whenever you went off the air, and I was just surfing on the AM dial and found you, and I'm so glad to have you back.
All right, my friend. I really, really appreciate that. Thank you. I'm glad you found us on AM there in Las Vegas. And we are. I hear. There's a long story there. I'm Mark Bell.
Some velvet morning when I'm straight, I'm gonna open up your gate.
I guess we're busted because somebody's sending me a Lone Voice is sending me a message on the wormhole, and they are apparently, they've let the cat out of the bag, and it seems as though, I just heard the news about your Thanksgiving Day marathon. KABC in Los Angeles is going to play us from, I don't know what it is, like 6 in the morning till 6 at night. Right. In Los Angeles, they're going to be playing us on Thanksgiving from 6 in the morning till 6 at night. Now, that's really going to probably irritate the hell out of a lot of people and also enjoy. I think you're going to enjoy it. We have picked, of course, some of the very best programs to air all day long in Los Angeles, but I totally cracked up when I heard about this plan. And I didn't think they were going to announce it to anybody. I thought they were just going to do it. But it's pretty cool. Can you imagine that? Midnight in the desert, all day long on Thanksgiving in Los Angeles. That, believe me, is going to get some people's attention. You know, people that have never heard the show, for example. My goodness. It's hard to imagine. I thought they were going to keep it secret, but the cat is plainly out of the bag. Therefore, I guess I feel free to. So, yes, who sent that? I really need smaller print so I can get everything. It's Lone Voice. Lone Voice, thank you. Apparently, now certainly everybody does know about it. They announced it, so I guess it's okay to talk about, right? On the day, on the air all day in Los Angeles on Thanksgiving Day. People so full of turkey that they can't move to even turn me off. What a world. Let's go to a Skype and see who's here. Hello.
Hi, this is Bodan. I'm calling from Canada.
Canada. Yes, my tasty friend. Go right ahead.
And just started listening to your show for the first time yesterday. Very intrigued. Having trouble sleeping, so I thought I'd give you a quick shout.
May I ask a question before you do? You said you just began listening like yesterday. So how did you learn of the show? How did you learn about the program?
I was just going to brush my teeth yesterday and turned on the radio, and I started listening to your show, and it kind of hit me. Your topic, and I don't remember what you spoke about yesterday, but the topic was really interesting. I thought, I'm going to give you guys a try another night tonight if I'm having trouble falling asleep. So here I am again.
All right. Well, the way the show works is the first 4 days of the week, we're pretty serious. You know, we have guests on, and then Friday night, Saturday morning, we throw caution to the wind and we just open the lines. We don't screen calls. We just do what we're doing now.
Cool. Well, the reason for my call is, so well, I'm not one of your, I think it's called it a prepper, from what I understand.
You're breaking up a little bit now on Skype.
Okay, I'm calling from my BlackBerry. But the reason for my call is to talk to you guys about ayahuasca.
Oh, yes.
And implants. I don't know if I heard something, somebody was talking about implants earlier.
Yes.
And I went to Peru to have one of these ayahuasca experiences. And during this experience, I don't know how much you know about ayahuasca, but it's a shaman medicine from thousands of years ago.
Oh, I know enough. I know enough, sir, about it. Trust me.
Okay. Maybe for your other people that are listening too. But anyways, in this experience, one of the things that came out was a lot about aliens and how, I don't know if I was in another dimension or something, and how I was getting implants put into me. And during this ceremony, one of the things that happened was I was getting these implants pulled out of me. And I kind of physically had to do it myself in some cases. But just wondering, from your past experience, past guests, any of your guests have any similar experience to this one?
Oh, yes. I have had many guests talk about DMT and ayahuasca. Absolutely. So keep listening. We talk about that kind of thing here. Trust me. We've had a number of people on who talked 3 hours about it. What the experience was like. DMT is even wilder and faster, I guess, right?
I guess it was my first time doing it. I went down there just kind of from a learning experience, and plus, I actually heard your commercial, I guess, was on back.
You're again breaking up. You're again breaking up, sir. Now, I don't know whether that means... All right, we're going to have to... I'll tell you what. Here's the key. If you've got wireless internet, you're going to have to be pretty close to your router. And if that doesn't do it, then you're going to have a talk with your internet company. Because generally, as a general rule, carrying Skype is a pretty easy thing to do, frankly. It's not bad at all. So it doesn't take a lot of internet to carry Skype. It takes relatively jitterless internet to carry Skype well. And most people aren't going to even know what that means. First-time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Good evening, Art. Thank you so much for taking my call.
Sure.
Long-time listener, first-time caller, and it's like meeting an old member of the family that has disappeared. Thank you for coming back.
Well, you're very welcome, and I'm glad that I did not spontaneously actually completely disappear. Like the story
I have. That's why I'm calling you this evening.
Oh.
Yes. And now this is not an ayahuasca experience I'm about to share with you.
Okay.
And I don't want to frighten our Canadian listeners.
All right.
Let me tell you two very quick examples. These are called bilocation, and they may be related to spontaneous disappearance as well. That's what I believe. I'm trained in the hard sciences, so what I speak of tonight is by direct experience and by very clear observation when these things happened. In 1975, when I was living in Little Rock, Arkansas, I was separated from very close friends of mine in Wisconsin, some that your friend Mr. Strieber knows very well, and I showed up at one of their parties one evening in the middle of a doorway, and I assure you that Madison, Wisconsin is a great deal distance from Little Rock, Arkansas.
Oh, yes.
Stood in the doorway, people came up to me, talked to me, but I didn't respond back, and I disappeared in front of them. Now, I had no memory of doing this. I had no consciousness of doing this. It happened during the times of day when I would have been sleeping and so forth. But it was obviously a condition of bilocation where I physically showed up and many people saw me standing there at the same time. At the same time, I know it catches your breath for a moment, but I think part of this is quantum entanglement, and we could get into that. But the bottom line is the second thing, there is a very steep road in Little Rock, Arkansas called Markham. It goes up and down and up and down, and you can't see the drivers who are coming on the other side of the hill very well.
Yeah.
On one particular day, the roads were particularly slippery. I came up over a hill, came down to where a stop sign was, could not stop because of the ice. Another car was coming at me. One of those station wagons used to have the fake wood on the side of them, if you'll remember them.
Sure.
And we pass through each other. Now, hold your breath for a moment. Let me explain this. I literally could experience his body, his car, the people in his car passing through me, and what he was thinking and experiencing simultaneously.
Wow.
We both hit our brakes and stopped immediately when we could and slowed down, and I believe it freaked out this gentleman.
Okay, well, that really deserves a wow. And so let me ask you, when you were passing through, was there enough time for you to sort of understand what you were feeling from him?
Yes. I've had the near-death experience, so I can only tell you it's similar to that where your life flows suddenly in front of you and you have a simultaneous multiple experience on all levels, like an all-knowing experience.
Right.
And it was literally, I was almost like him momentarily with his family, his feelings, his history, his background. He must have felt mine too, which probably scared him considering the things that I've been through. So he probably had nightmares for months. So all I can tell you, even though we teach in physics that two objects cannot be in the same space at the same time, I'm telling you, these things can occur where you can actually physically be in the same place at the same time and, from the previous experience, absolutely disappear from that other position.
All right. Were you doing this consciously or subconsciously?
Neither experience was consciously done.
Too bad. You should give it a shot. See if you can meditate and jump.
Oh, Mr. Bell, I'm far beyond that at this point.
Really?
I can do things that a certain major of yours would probably have a Pampers Day if I told him what I could do from a distance.
Really?
Oh, yes. The whole thing with the remote viewer thing about, well, we can only observe, we can't affect what's at a distance.
Yeah. Remote.
That's baloney.
Really?
Oh, yes.
What can you do? Lay it out.
You can perform and affect the physical environment as well as a non-physical environment at any distance. At any distance. And people who are purveyors of these skills, who know about these for centuries, probably eons in our cultures and temples and other places, knew about it. But it is not a plaything. It is nothing to play with or mess with. And I assure you, we have people, sort of the Chinese, the Russians, and others, who have used these kind of skills to affect the health of leaders for generations.
So you're saying remote influencing is not only real, but you're really good at it.
Oh, of course. Yes.
Oh,
and you have to have. I believe there is a standard of ethic that you have to have.
Oh, darn!
I come from a school that says you harm none. Period.
Really?
And that means you have to be careful when you drop that pebble in the stream or in the lake. Remember the ripples that you let loose, and that takes a very strong sense of ethics. Just because you have a skill, as my teacher in fourth grade said, just because you have a pencil doesn't mean you should put it in your ear.
Yeah.
Same thing with these skills. Just simply because you have the skill doesn't mean you should use it for purposes that I believe are immoral, unethical, and downright dangerous.
Too bad, because I was about to hire you.
No.
Money on the table.
No. I will not do that. I will tell you a story.
Gotta be short.
I don't want to take other listeners' time.
Yes.
I had a very close girlfriend who I was with for some time who was a stockbroker. And she handed me the paper one day and said, well, if you're so good at this, tell me which stocks I should buy in the market and so forth. And I went bingity, 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 and said, this and this and this, these will go up, this will go down, blah, blah, handed it over to her, gave her 12 stocks, and that was it. The next day, she came back and she said, if I had done what you said, I would have made $1 million today. I want you to help. I said, I won't do it. Let's just say that relationship didn't last long.
Not bad.
Yeah, it can be done. But you must have the ethics to go with it. If you don't have the ethics, you shouldn't even have that tool. But that's not why I called you about the disappearances, that there is a primordial characteristic of matter and energy in our universe that allows us to be in two places at the same time and possibly vaporize and be at this other place.
So you know, down, you're well aware of the Walmart restroom thing, right?
You know, there are a lot of restrooms in this country that are along highways you could disappear into, and I'm not going to get into about 10,000 people disappear permanently every year.
Actually, it's the truth. They do. I know they do. And it just can't be explained. You're going to want to read the article that is at artbell.com about this. Seriously.
I have looked a little through it. I'll look some more. But I just want to thank you so much, Art, for your time and be a family member for all of us who are nighttime listeners in the world. And I think after the thing in Los Angeles, you're going to have probably a replay in daytime forever. You're going to grab them. You're going to grab them, Art. It's coming.
All right, sir. Thank you very much. We'll have to see how that works out. But I laughed and laughed and laughed. I mean, of all ideas, can you imagine doing Midnight in the Desert from 6 in the morning till 6 at night in Los Angeles? There are going to be... Well, I don't want to make predictions. Anyway, I know we picked four pretty good shows. That's what it'll take, is four shows. It's going to be wild. I think Los Angeles is the nation's second radio market. The way it works is New York. Hey, WABC. New York is number one. And Los Angeles is the second radio market, and Chicago is the third radio market. Let's go to Cincinnati on the phone. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Not actually Cincinnati.
Well, all I can go by is what it says on my phone. It says Cincinnati on my phone. I'm sorry.
It is. No, it's not your fault. This is Alicia of Roswell, first of all. I am actually currently in Cottonwood, Arizona, but I live in Phoenix now. Just haven't changed the phone.
No, wait a minute. At what point were you in Cincinnati?
A very long time. That's why the phone still has the 513.
Wow. All right.
Now in Phoenix, home of the lights. Much more exciting. So I want to say that, first of all, I have to say hi to Byte 9 and to my husband, who is sitting next to me, who is your biggest fan. He is he's a ham radio operator, just like you.
All right.
He is the reason I'm listening to your show.
Well, then you obviously have good taste. You married an amateur radio operator.
Mm-hmm. So I want to say this. I am not a long-time listener. I am a new listener, all because of him. And this relates to my story. I want to talk about ghosts.
Okay.
I feel like listening to the show has kind of opened my mind. I was a skeptic for a very long time. And what's been happening is I'm having these dreams that are very vivid, where I can walk through a wall and I can feel every bit of it.
Really?
It takes all the energy I have, and I know that I come across a wall and I think I've got to get to the other side, and I feel myself going through this wall. It's like the most concentration you can possibly have. And so I'm wondering, just kind of throwing it out to the listeners, is it an experience from the past? Is it an experience from the future? Is it out of body? It's the weirdest, most real thing that I've ever felt. And I know you've talked about some sleep issues before, and I had sleep paralysis and some of the other things, but this is something I feel like other people might have some wisdom on, and I just wanted to kind of throw it out there.
Well, I appreciate your doing that. And you haven't heard about this Walmart restroom thing, right?
Well, I've been hearing a little.
A little, yeah. Okay. Well, then there you are. It's getting around. All right. Thank you very, very much for the call, and please call again. I am now informed by the evil Roland that I said it wrong, that KBC will indeed be playing us all day long. But actually, this is better because, you know, who the heck gets up at 6 a.m. on Thanksgiving anyway? It'll be from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. on Thanksgiving. And then, of course, we'll have a repeat beginning at then. So actually, it's longer than that, right? If it's 9 in the morning till 9 at night, well, there might be an hour in between. Then there'll be another show. Anyway, that's what it says, 9 in the morning till 9 at night. Michael, hello. On Skype, hello.
Art?
Michael?
Okay, I've got a bit of a delay. I'm on Skype on the iPhone.
You sound all right to me.
Perfect. So listen, I have a potential revenue stream for you that I haven't seen tapped in yet.
Okay.
Midnight in the Desert Dating.
Yeah, I'm going to double tap you and kick you off my line.
Have a nice night.
Yeah, you too. Double tap for sure. Not even going there. Hi, on the first time caller line, you are on the air.
Hi, I was just calling to tell you about why some people prep.
Oh, good. Excellent. You're a first time caller. You've never called the show before, right?
No.
Oh, okay. All right, then. Lay it on me. Why do people prep?
Well, I think some people are interested in a kind of like old-timey lifestyle or camping, outdoorsy lifestyle, and it appeals to them to collect certain items, like the certain tools of the trades, as it were, like camping gear, all these different items, and just build those skills as it relates to just a simpler life. And I think it comes out of a fear that we won't be able to protect our children, have them in a warm place. You know, if the electricity goes out, if society breaks down, you want to have a lot of stuff.
Okay, well, let's go beyond that, even a step beyond it. Do you think that the people you're talking about sort of secretly hope something bad will happen?
No, I think that's like a really rare, maybe that's more of the, like, you know, fanatic people. They don't, I think they're more violent. There's a violent obsession or something there. And that's where it connects for them to, like, the guns and the knives.
I'm telling you, sir, I think there's more of those people than you would imagine.
Oh, there probably is. But, you know, I sure hope they don't rear their ugly heads and do that kind of stuff. Because, you know, a lot of the people that are sitting in the background, too, that aren't like that, they are just as prepared. They're just as prepared to, you know, run out their front door and protect their neighbor.
I would like to imagine that if something really awful happened, you know, we would all take care of each other, share our rations and our water. But, you know, that just doesn't match up with reality and human nature.
Yeah, it's true. And people are throwing up fences and building their houses, you know, more and more taller and going within their own houses and technology and entertainment within, and they're not coming outdoors and doing those things that I think make you realize that these, and make young people realize that these weapons and guns and things that are military-grade assault rifles, it's true, you don't need that stuff to be prepared. You could go out with a hunting rifle, bolt-action rifle, and hunt and learn to survive out and be very, very much more prepared than some person who just sits in their house and obsesses about how much gear they have on their assault rifle. That's not a reasonable thing to prepare. That's not being prepared.
I agree with you. What do you think the most likely scenario is for needing the kind of stuff we're talking about here?
Oh, something that, you know, maybe is not as expected as we thought. Like, really smart people that I've heard, really smart astronomers, and say that, you know, asteroids could hit the planet. And weird stuff like that that seems unfathomable to us could actually happen, you know, and send up dust clouds, or even Mount St. Helens. I live over here in the Northwest, and Mount St. Helens blew up and sent out huge dust clouds and just stuff like that, you know. Not a realistic long, I don't see people living long-term apocalypse style living Mad Max stuff. That, I think that's kind of unrealistic. I think if we degrade past the point of like the cowboy days in 1870s, we're pretty much done for at that point. But if we could go back to horse, that's why I really like that, like I said, this old-timey preparedness and that prepper where you learn leather work, you learn woodwork, you learn hand tools.
Sure.
And there's nothing wrong with that in the sense, a large knife in that sense is not scary to me. Someone wearing a large knife, if they told me walking down the street they're a prepper, I wouldn't get worried, you know, even if they look, they're in camouflage and they're kind of scary looking.
Well, if society, if society reverted to a time before radio, then what would I be? I might as well just cease to exist, you know, head to a Walmart restroom. Hello there on Skype. You're on the air.
Hi.
Hi.
Well, I've kind of been recently concerned about the events in society lately, and actually there was an incident that kind of frightened me and kind of wants me to just be aware of what's going on and kind of prepare a little bit.
What is it you think you're preparing for? In other words, what do you see happening?
Well, the general way society is going already is, you know, scary with people with guns and knives. And I had a friend who, a guy with a knife just walked right into her house.
Really?
One night. And that has me scared, so...
Yeah, I think that's maybe the scariest thing of all. We could all imagine carjackings or something, but somebody just breaking down your door or breaking a window and getting in your house, my God, that's scary.
Yeah, and she only lives like an hour and a half from me.
Whew.
So since then, I've gotten a dog for alarm purposes, and... Well, more than about that, but he's a very good alarm. And I want to have a weapon on hand just in case I need to use one.
Well, a dog alarms about everything. They alarm about, well, you know, like when the mail gets there. They alarm when the trash truck gets there. They send you alarms about everything, sometimes all the time.
Well, this one is kind of discriminatory about what he barks at. If he's not sure if he should be barking, he doesn't bark as loud.
So there's a sort of like a, if it's really loud, uh-oh.
And if there's somebody at the door, he goes absolutely freaking nuts.
Okay.
Sorry about the language.
Well, that's all right.
Yeah, he goes absolutely nuts if somebody's at the door, so... anyway, that's... kind of where I'm at with this.
What's in your kit to survive?
I'm just trying to build one now. I waiting for a
Other than food, water, and maybe a radio, what else would seem essential to you? Something that you use, well, let's say every day and wouldn't feel comfortable without.
I always have candles nearby in case of a power failure.
Candles are good. Sure.
If I ever get to move to my new home, I also want to install solar electric. I'm one of those people that would not survive without electricity.
What would be the, I'm with you. What would be the most frivolous item you would include?
Most frivolous?
That's right. Some guilty pleasure, no doubt.
Well, I'm trying to give up tobacco, so I think that a lot of people would want to include tobacco in their kit.
Well,
it's a pretty strong addiction.
Yeah, it's an incredibly strong addiction. And, you know, even if you didn't smoke, you'd want to have several cartons of cigarettes because, man, you could bargain away. You know, you wait until they're like in the second stage of withdrawal, then you pull them out and demand a house and trade and get it.
Teach to leave them kids alone.
Walk on the wild side of midnight. From the Kingdom of Nye, this is Midnight in the Desert with Art Bell. Please call the show at 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Well, that's one way, and then, of course, there's Skype.
You sound so good if you do it right.
Just put us in. North America's MITD 51, and the rest of the world is MITD 55, and it's a free call, too. You can be on the... What a world we live in now, right? You can be on the other side of the world, load your phone up with just whatever I told you, and sound great on a worldwide talk show and do it for free. That is What a World Time. All right, we have two additional lines open tonight for your dialing pleasure. One is the prepper line. And it's not so much I want to know what you're doing as why you're doing it, what you expect. But I'll take a little of both. Area code 575-208-7787. That's the prepper line. At area code 575-208-7787 and the first-time caller line. This one's really good for those who have never called the show. Area code 775-285-5800. 775-285-5800. We don't normally give those out during the week, but what the heck, right? Barbara, hello, Barbara.
Hi.
Hi.
I didn't ever think I was ever going to get on.
Oh, but yet it occurred.
Well, thank you.
Where are you, Barbara?
I'm in Phoenix.
Phoenix, okay.
And I'm not prepping for nothing.
Not at all, huh?
No. You know? I have enough to do with cleaning the house and everything else.
So, in other words, if it all came apart and the tide hit the fan...
Yep.
Because you do a lot of cleaning. I thought I'd throw that in. You'd be out of luck, huh?
I'd be out of luck. Well, I mean, what would I do? Run away to the mountains, and I'd have to bring my cats, my cat food.
Yeah.
And in about a day and a half later, my cats would run off, and I'd be, like, yeah, wondering what to do out there.
They don't travel well anyway.
Yeah, they don't. Well, anyway, this is about residual hauntings.
Oh.
For which I've heard, you know, for years about residual hauntings, and they've always been kind of disappointing to me because they basically mean that there's nothing happening. It's just a loop, right?
Yes. A continuing vibration, maybe. I think, good. I mean, if it's not really a soul trapped in a repetitive thing forever, then... yay, because that sounds a little horrific to me.
Yeah, you're right. Maybe you won't like this, actually.
Oh?
Yeah, because I have a friend, and she has a house that's built near a graveyard in Pennsylvania.
Yes.
So every night, she, about 10 o'clock, which I didn't even know it was so regular, but she sees a smoky black mass.
Oh.
Yes, in the hall, across from her bedroom.
Yes.
And it goes down the hall a few steps and then into the closet. So that's very much like a residual haunting. This has been going on for like a year or something, a couple of years. So the other night, for whatever reason, she thought, you know, her husband had passed away a few years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So for some reason or other, I guess she got into her head, maybe it's my husband. So she went out there. She's terrified of this thing. But she called out her husband's name, Dan. And the smoky mass where the head would be turned to her.
Yes.
And she described it as it suddenly... how did she describe it? It fractured and broke up. She said it was like a newspaper consumed by the wind in a fire, and that it just suddenly blew away, crinkled away, what she said.
Only at the calling of the name?
Only at the calling of the name.
Yikes.
Which means that possibly residual hauntings are not just somebody repeating something over and over again, a visual loop, that there could be someone there.
That's really creepy.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Really
I
creepy.
To
I mean,
say that.
Yeah. What if, you know, you did a certain level of bad in your life, and you've got to keep repeating that forever? I mean, that's true hell.
Isn't that awful?
Sure, it's awful.
So I always wanted to say that to you, and I'm so glad I got in to talk to you because I love your show.
Well, I'm glad you got in too, but now that's going to be on my mind. You know.
I know.
Forever.
Well. I don't know. I just thought that would be an interesting insight into ghosts because people are kind of, you know, it's just a residual haunting.
Appreciate your call. Thank you. And that will be on my mind for a while now. That's kind of like the don't go to the light. It's a trick. I would like to interview John Lear, if for no other reason than to ask him about that quote. I wonder if John still thinks that. I'm sure that he's been on talk shows and people have asked him, right? I wonder if he still believes that's true. All right, let's go all the way out of the country. Tom, wherever you are, you're on the air. Hello, Tom. Going once, Tom. We have no audio from you. Going twice, Tom, and gone. My guess is that was probably somebody from North America jumping in on the wrong line. First time caller line, you are on the air.
Hello, Art.
Hi.
My name's Mike. I'm in Las Vegas.
Hey, Mike.
How you doing? I make it a point to listen to you every night. I love your show.
Thank you.
August 25th last year, we threw a big pool party slash birthday party for a friend of mine. There were like 20, 30 guests there.
Okay.
And at about 5 minutes after midnight, the party started breaking up, and there was about maybe a dozen people left in around the pool.
Mm-hmm.
And I just happened to look up in the sky, and I started screaming, "Everybody look." And I was looking right over the light of the Luxor Hotel. And I stopped counting after 12.
12 what?
There were 12 lights in the sky in two formations in circles. There were six in the front and six in the back. Two circle formations of what we saw as UFOs.
Well, you know, I've thought about the Luxor for a long time, and that's such a bright light, sir, that you know if anything's out there, including our own space station, the Luxor light is one thing you're not going to miss.
Yeah, exactly. And what I thought it was being used for was a buoy marker. But because when the first pod of six got over the light, they started doing what an airplane would be called an aileron roll. They just started flipping over and over, like, you know, like the kids were out with the parents and they were dancing in the sandbox.
Did you think to whip out your camera? And
I was in the pool laying back.
Oh, yeah.
And I just happened to be looking up at the sky. Now, we live up, the house we got is up on the hill on Hollywood,
well, don't tell me exactly where you are, right?
So we got a beautiful view of the city.
Right.
There's no moon out. It's a beautiful, clear sky. And these things came out of the southeast going over toward the northwest.
Well, maybe your report, sir, will generate some other witnesses in Vegas.
Well, we tried to call, you know, Action 13 and the news, go outside, take a look up, and by the time we were, you know, we actually got somebody to listen to us, they were gone.
Well, of course. You know, that's always the way it is. I mean, literally, always the way it is. Or something happened in the pictures, or they're fuzzy. But there's always the possibility that somebody else saw what you saw. So that's what makes me take those calls. And, you know, I always hope that, well, actually a whole lot of people saw it and they were just didn't report it to anybody. You know, they didn't. You do see strange things in Vegas, after all. Let's go to, I don't know, the phone. Somebody. Hello.
Hey, Art. How you doing?
I'm doing well, sir.
Okay, I'm a prepper. I keep at least 6 months of food on hand, so it's just a prudent thing to have.
But you didn't call my prepper line.
Well, I didn't know I had to.
You don't.
Yeah. So, what I was going to say, it's nice to have a hunting rifle with five rounds in it. It's good for, you know, getting food. But if you've got a horde of zombies after you,
zombies?
Zombies, people, killers, starving, hungry people.
You know, after the show I did the other night, remember that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A guy named Philip sent me the Zombie Survival Guide. So I have that now.
Well, there you go. I mean, what would you rather have, an AR or a 30-06?
It depends on the vintage, but I frankly would rather have an AK.
There you go.
Those things shoot when nothing else will.
Yeah, they get heavy, though. A lot of, almost twice the weight.
Well, there is that. But, I mean, they can get muddy, they can get dusty, they can get dirty. And for the most part, they still shoot.
That's true. You can get ARs that are piston-operated now, too, that basically operate the same.
Sure. Do you expect something alike, you know, like a zombie apocalypse or something?
Yeah, we are headed down to a convergence coming up in the next 2 years. I think, you know, a lot of people, you know, say, Planet X, what are you, crazy? It's not there. Everything else is smoke and mirrors to keep you occupied so you don't know about what's coming.
So you think, you're a Planet X guy, you think Planet X is going to crash into us?
It's not going to crash into us. It's going to pass by us and everything that's associated with it.
Well, it might strip away our atmosphere, like Mars.
Well, if it got close enough, that's what happened to Mars, as a matter of fact. It's when it ran into Phaeton. One of its passing, supposedly it or one of its moons smacked into Phaeton.
Could have been a large rock, too, just grazing the atmosphere. Or it could have been the sun with a giant hit that stripped the atmosphere away from Mars. Could have been a lot of things.
Yeah, a lot of people think it's a nuclear holocaust, too. But it's coming. If you look, punch up the International Space Station, got some photographs of it, and that was just released.
Wait. The International Space Station has photographs of Planet X?
Uh-huh. Punch it up.
Oh, come on.
Do a Google search. It was released. I'm telling you, I'll send it to you.
Okay. All right. Send it to me. Absolutely send it to me. If you've got it, I swear I'll share it. Taken from the International Space Station. Planet X on its way. All right. Fire away, sir. Send it to Art Bell at KNYE.com. Art Bell at KNYE.com. Now, I'm going to try again here with Tom. Tom has been calling here again and again, trying, and then hanging up. Are you actually there now, Tom?
Can you hear me?
I do.
Oh, great. I'm sorry before. First time I called on Skype to you, and so, you know. Anyway, I'm not calling from the States. Actually, I'm calling from way across the other side of the world, and this is the honest of God's truth. I'm calling from Beijing, China, baby.
Are you really?
I am. In fact, I became a time traveler before I left because I needed to have a lifeline back to the States.
Yeah, okay, well, here's something that I've got to challenge you with, Beijing Tom. You ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Hit me with it. Our show is not allowed in communist China.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I have a VPN for most of my stuff, for Facebook and
okay.
All the other stuff, my Gmail.
Good answer, actually.
Beijing.
All right, maybe you are in Beijing. All right, what time?
I'm not using a VPN now, so
okay, sir.
Go ahead.
What time is it in Beijing?
It's approximately 2:54.
Well, it'd be 2:51.
Okay, my clock is passing.
But yeah, that's close enough. Okay, I believe you.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I'm teaching English at a nice school here, so I took a 1-year contract for the adventure and the excitement.
Well, I know about a lot of people that go to Hong Kong and they teach English, but you're the first one way up in China. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, there's quite a few expatriates in Beijing, but Beijing is so huge. It's 20 plus million people.
Yeah, I hear it's so slightly air polluted as well.
Oh my gosh, and it's going to be getting worse because in the winter, you know, they fire up the they increase the coal factory plants because you know they got to heat all these apartments.
Wow!
So it's been pretty bad the past few weeks, but everybody's telling me at the school it's within the next month or two it's going to get. You know, pretty hazy. So anyway, you know, I sometimes wear my little face mask. And
well, you are totally my first call from mainland China. So very cool.
Yeah, it is. I'm a little long in the tooth. Most people taking these jobs are in their, you know, late 20s, 30s. I'm close to 52, so
that's okay.
You know, I wanted to have a little adventure my last 30 years of productivity or so.
What's it like living in China? Can you tell me and everybody?
It is constant and it's constant people. There's so many people wherever you go. I mean, of course, it's just so crowded. The buses and the subways, you know, if you hit it at a bad time, you know, you've probably seen the YouTube videos. They're packed like sardines.
Mm-hmm.
The food is very good. I mean, if you like Chinese, of course. So I get my chow mein and chow fan, whatever, you know, when I can. But what it's like, it's, you know, I'm sort of an oddity because I'm a Westerner, and the section that I live in is far west of like Tiananmen Square downtown.
Mm-hmm.
So even though where I live, it still looks like a big giant megapolis, but it's actually considered like the suburb of Beijing. And so where I live is I'm one of probably about eight, I don't know, four or five Westerners living in this area. So when I walk out, you know, you get the stares and you get,
sure,
you know, people are, sure, constantly looking at you. But I mean, for the most part, what it's like, it's been a bit of a culture shock. I got to tell you, I kind of miss the blue skies of Pennsylvania where I'm from. And I miss the pretty gardens and, you know, the slow traffic.
Sure.
The traffic is horrible.
Oh,
here.
I know about traffic.
Go ahead.
So I hope you will call us again. I mean, really, you're revealing all kinds of interesting things because I did not know. I was under the impression that our show was blacklisted and didn't make it into China. But, I mean, quite obviously, it does.
I get you without my VPN. So I go into my time traveler, I download,
wow,
and I don't use a VPN. So Dark Matter, I forget your address, Dark Matter is free to go. So,
all right, and you also, please, you also get the live show?
Yeah, in fact, I was listening to it live on the bus. I was using my data on my cell phone, and I just got home because I did some grocery shopping, and I thought I'd call in. I had one query for you. You know, I've been thinking about time traveling,
yes,
and I just want to pose this question. If I could, I just wonder if I could time travel back to myself somehow mentally and give myself advice back when I was 20, or
if you could do that, what would you tell your 20-year-old self?
You know, I would say, you know, study harder. I would say quit goofing around with, you know, this stuff and that stuff. But, you know, there's also, I don't know, it's just like, I just constantly wonder about it, you know. If I could sort of give myself the advice, and what would I give it? And then when I think of that, Art, I think, well, if I do that and then I do alter myself in the past,
right,
will I be in Beijing now? You know, would I have done all the stuff I've done? Would I have had the family I've had? You know, so, you know, it's a quandary to think about.
All right. Well, listen, brother, I've got to go. We've got a break and I've got to go. But, okay, Tom, call me again.
I'd love to. Thank you, Art. Thank you for everything.
Take care. If you can hear us on a bus in Beijing, on a bus in Beijing, China, I'm Art Bell. This is Midnight in the Desert.
Initiate a dialogue sequence with Art Bell. Please coordinate your phalanges and call 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Or if you're a prepper, we have a prepper line at 775. No, that's wrong. That's our first-time caller line. 775-285-5800. Preppers call 575 575- 575-208-7787. Again, 575-208-7787. And, of course, if you're on a bus in Beijing, whew, that was so cool. That really was cool. Imagine it. These days, you can do a radio program, and you've got a listener on a bus in Beijing. That really tops them all so far. I love getting calls from outside the area, but that one really took the cake. So if you're out in the world somewhere, the wide, wide world, reach us, please, for free using Skype, and simply put us in as MITD55. Anywhere in the rest of the world, MITD55. That was cool, really cool. Okay, let's go. First time caller, Houston, you're on the air.
Hi, yes, sir. My name's Jose, and I'm from Houston, Texas.
Welcome, Jose.
Yes, sir. I called for the first time caller line, but I'm also a prepper.
Oh. That is a problem. Can't have you on both at once. That's all right. Why are you prepping?
I am prepping because I have a lot of trust in the government and the current situation that things are going in the world.
I'm sorry. Did you say you don't have a lot of trust in the government, or you do?
No, I do not, sir.
Good move. Okay.
Yes, sir. I'm a veteran from the United States Marine Corps.
Right.
And after being in there for some time, I kind of came to realize that things just weren't where they needed to be. So I came home, did a lot of research, and I'm just really prepping for the day that the government turns its back on the citizens.
When they turn their back on us, that's an interesting way to put it. And by that, I guess you mean, have a pretty bad connection, but I guess you mean when they no longer protect us. A lot of people feel as though the government turned its back on them. What about the Katrina victims? And a lot of others. If you're going to be in a disaster, you've got to be in a big one. Or you're better off being in a big one. Because then the government does help you. And, of course, Katrina was big. But, boy, it sure did feel like the government turned their back on those people, didn't it? I guess this man, you know, feels in a bigger way. And it could be coming, who knows, Vancouver, outside the country, but well within your rights to call this line. You're on the air.
Hello, Bart.
Hi.
This is Howard. I'm listening to you on KXL 101 FM out of Portland, Oregon.
Portland, Oregon. Yeah, what a signal, huh?
Yes. I talked to you the other night. I'm still nursing the bite marks I got from Kevin Randall in that conversation, but that's not what I wanted to talk to you about.
Wait a minute. Kevin gave you bite marks?
Yes, he sure did.
In what way?
You didn't pick up on that?
Well, I'm sorry. I'm not... What did he say that...
Well, all I had to do was mention Maury Island, and I might as well have I might as well have insulted his mother or something.
Yeah, I remember now.
He really went after me.
He did.
But at any rate, that isn't. I wondered if you'd mind if I suggested a guest for your program.
Not at all. Although I do have a producer.
Yes, yes, you do.
Who actually, you know, does that? But sure, well, go ahead.
Okay. Have you ever heard of Lionel Fanthorpe?
No.
You haven't. He's been an occasional guest on the other program that you started.
Oh.
And he is an Anglican priest. He's an octogenarian. But to give you an idea of his background, he's rides a Harley-Davidson motorcycle, and he used to teach martial arts to the SAS.
Wow.
And so he's quite a character, and he's a master storyteller.
Okay.
Now, and he has a staggering knowledge of history and everything paranormal, and he's I would just love to hear a conversation between you and him.
Okay. Sure. So... You need to send that off to my producer, and it's really easy. You just send it to producer@artbell.com.
Producer@artbell.com. Okay.
Yeah, is that easy? All right, thank you very much. Anybody, it's true of anybody out there. If you have somebody that you want to get on the air, just send off an email with the pertinent information, hopefully with the person's number. That'd be great. But if you don't have it, we'll do our own research. Producer@artbell.com. And speaking of which, I have a message from my producer, and she says, Lionel no longer does interviews. So there you have it. He no longer does interviews. I can only imagine she knows that because she has already made that attempt. He no longer does interviews. And I guess he's getting on up there and just doesn't want to do any more. And I get it. Let's go to, Mark, I think in Switzerland.
Yeah, hi, Art. Can you hear me?
I can hear you fine, Mark. I know that Switzerland is not yet affected, but man, oh man, that part of the world is really in trouble right now, Mark.
Well, let me tell you, there are armed policemen now in the railway stations.
Wow.
Here in Switzerland. And there's big discussion now about Switzerland leaving the Schengen agreement and reinstating full border controls.
Really?
Yes.
Really? Gosh, there are unprecedented things happening in the world right now. A little bit of fear goes a long, long way, doesn't it?
Yes, and many Swiss believe, Art, and I don't think this is conspiratorial, that this all the events happening now and the influx of the refugees is actually to bring each of the individual nation states of Europe to their knees for the creation of a United States of Europe.
I guess anything could happen. I've never quite seen a time like this in the modern world. Brussels, I guess you know what kind of condition they're in right now, right?
Yes, absolutely. But I tell you, speaking to the Swiss, I work with a lot of Swiss, and all of them think that this is a manufactured, situation.
Oh? You mean like false flag?
No, that this is a purposeful thing to restructure Europe. That Europe, to get rid of the individual nation states and create a pan-European government.
Do you think it will have that effect, or do you think, Mark, that countries are just going to begin closing their borders? I'm not sure which way it's going to go.
I don't know, but I just tell you, Art, that this is going to put a tremendous economic strain. It already is on the individual nation states.
Sure. Sure it will. And that's a good point. I guess that could force the result you're talking about.
Yes. And the Swiss are taking it very seriously. We had elections here just about a month ago, and it went to the right. There was a shift to the right, and they're talking about leaving Schengen already by the end of the year.
Wow. Yeah, it's a whole part of the world now, and you're going to have to excuse me, but the Middle East, and now increasingly Europe, Italy, most of Europe, is getting to be a scary place for people to contemplate going to visit. And that's not good economically either.
No, not at all. And one has to say, who's funding all of this? Who's funding all of this? Follow the money trail and find out who is benefiting from this.
Okay, why don't you do that for me and tell me where it leads you?
I think it leads to the Saudis and the U.S. I think the U.S. has been funding these groups all along. The U.S. always needs an enemy, Art.
Well, we always have one, that's for sure.
Yeah.
We are
manufactured. I think a lot of this is manufactured, Art.
Yeah, I kind of disagree with you. I think what we're facing right now is real. ISIS is real. Al-Qaeda is real.
Oh, it's real, but who put them in this position?
We did.
They didn't just create themselves.
Look. When you're looking at the caliphate and you say, who is responsible for that. The U.S. clearly. What we did in Iraq set the stage for everything going on right now.
I agree.
You know, that's not to say that it might not have happened anyway, but Mark, I've got to agree. It's our karma.
Yep.
All right.
Now, I'll keep you posted, Art, on all the decisions being made here.
All right.
Because it's quite interesting.
Please do. Thanks a million. Take care. That's Mark in Switzerland. Yeah, the world is in a state that I haven't seen it in my lifetime. Have you? The rest of you? And thank you, by the way, for the call all the way from Switzerland. That and a guy in a bus in Beijing. Wow. And again, for the rest of the world, MITD55 will get you here, free of charge. Skype. Let's go to Anchorage, Alaska on the phone. Hi.
Art.
Yes.
Yeah, I can't believe it, Art. It's been 2 hours and 45 minutes.
I'm very sorry. You know, it's busy. Very busy tonight.
No, I was busy downstairs. I forgot all about you. I still haven't shot here.
Anyway, are you talking directly into a phone or something?
You want me to take it off the speakerphone?
Oh, please.
All right, how's that?
Oh, it is so much better.
All right, so I made my list. Are you ready? First, I wanted to thank you for coming back on the air. I mean, I got a call earlier and called you timeless, Art. I am excited to be able to talk to you after all these years. But
thank you.
Your popularity, I think, will probably overwhelm that opportunity pretty soon here. Are there rules to calling into your show, like once a week or a month or something, or?
Well, right now it's no more than one call a day. And then, of course, no bad language. And on days like Friday night, Saturday morning, there is a two-drink maximum.
And marijuana, I hope, being legalized here. So just bring that into conversation.
So it depends upon the state you're calling from.
It does. Let's see. Well, let me go through my list real quick, and I'll make a comment if that's okay.
Sure.
Okay, first of all, I was pronounced dead at birth, and I say that not for self-indulgence, but reference.
I was going to guess that anyway.
Right, me too. That's your reason for some things. Anyway, just for reference, I've had a wide array of experiences. And one of them was that I had a picture painted by emotions. And I know that sounds nuts, but just for those people out there, in case they're wondering. And I'll go through my list real quick here of what I'd like to see. I'd like to see us review the top 20 UFO videos. I'm seeing amazing, just an astounding array of videos now coming in from around the world. It's just unbelievable what I'm seeing. And, you know, I've met Linda Moulton Howe and Travis and all of them, and so many years ago. Then let's see, for those of you smoking, I did quit smoking. I think I had an intervention. And right now you don't have a clue, so don't be too heavy on yourselves. You blame yourself, but you really don't know why you do. I think we're going to have to deal with overpopulation very quickly. That's going to have to be something we have to start dealing with right away. And then I wanted to drop back to the NASA. You had Kevin Randall on the other night.
Hmm.
And I proposed that NASA could do something about this whole thing. And I think you and him kind of backed that off, and I kind of wanted to push the case again. I don't see how NASA escapes being our eyes in the space. It's unacceptable, and I don't see how they can get outside of our influence. All they need to do is put up a 360 camera with telescoping and zooming capability.
All right. Well, we're going to have to hold your list there, sir. But we can say what we want from NASA, but we better come up with a few bucks. I mean, really. NASA's budget gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and our expectations for NASA get bigger and bigger and bigger. I think we need to back it up with money. I really mean that, money. And people say, oh, no, 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 no. If we don't get busy and set a goal for ourselves, something that, you know, is going to be really hard to do, whether it's going to Mars or whatever, we're going to atrophy as a nation. That's what I believe. As a nation, it's already begun. We're going to atrophy. What is that? Well, if you are lazy and don't use something, it after a while it will atrophy, right? Your arm, your leg, your muscles, you've got to use them or you atrophy. And that's kind of mentally what's happening to America. We don't have a clear goal. We have clear fears, but not a clear goal anyway. Off soapbox. Skype, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, how are you doing, Art?
Quite well, thank you.
It's an amazing show you have tonight.
It is.
A lot of crazy things going on, eh?
Mm-hmm.
The guy runs through a car into another person, and, well, you know, it kind of throws back to your other show you had the other night with Matrix whole thing.
Well, I'm not sure that's Matrix, but it might be.
Oh, you never know, eh?
You never know.
If it's all a digital world, it could be just a glitch.
Yeah. When I saw this picture on my own website of people who spontaneously ceased to exist, I looked at that picture and I went, did you see it?
Yeah. Oh, by the way, Art, I would like to ask if you're all right, and everyone was worried from DM Talk whether if you're okay and whatever.
Yeah, you know, I'm sorry. I put a message on my Facebook. I was just not feeling well. It's as simple as that. So I took a day off.
Enough said.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, move on. Anyways, what they really wanted me to tell you about was a story I have. Goes back to Milton, Ontario. It was Halloween, actually, close to Halloween, about 2 years ago. And I was coming back from a friend's house. It was about 4 a.m. in the morning. And, wow. Anyway, I'm going over this bridge. And it's like, it's a town where a lot of water runs through it. So there's a culvert with running water and cement edges.
Yeah, gotta hurry this up a little
bit. Okay, the animal jumped right up over top of that bridge, landed in front of me, and it looked like a rabbit. It looked like it was covered in some kind of oil, like it came out of a tar slick. But the damn thing must have jumped about 15 feet to get over top of that bridge.
How does a rabbit covered with oil jump 15 feet?
Well, anyway, it bolted and it ran like a rabbit, about 4 feet tall, and it had the ears and everything.
Oh, four feet tall.
Well, I saw it, and I sure as hell wasn't hallucinating. The rest of the street and everything didn't disappear, so I don't believe I was hallucinating. Everything else I saw around me was perfectly the same.
What a world, eh? Okay, that's a Canadian thing. I think sometimes that's how it begins with them. They're born. The first thing they ever hear is, he's alive, eh? They are quite a breed up there. Let's go to, it looks like, North Carolina. Hello on the phone.
From the high mountains of Madison County, North Carolina, I bid you greeting, Mr. Art Bell. I've been listening to you since 1995.
Oh, that's the way to do it.
Yeah. My wife is a big Walking Dead fan, and your show, you're talking about the preppers earlier, got me thinking about some stuff that, or one thing that I thought about watching the show, which I like, but I didn't want to depress her. But, you know, all the nuclear reactors left in the country, it couldn't happen.
Hopefully not. So, anyway, are you a prepper?
No, sir. Yeah. No, sir. I'm not a prepper. That's why I didn't call the prepper line.
Good.
But I did do some looking around the internet, and I got thinking about, you know, if something happened and, you know, the reactors didn't go, you know, online you can look and you can find simple ways of making, like, hand crank generators, you know, with really cheap parts. And I really think, I mean, I'm still trying to learn it, but I mean, I really think that would be a good thing for people to maybe look up on and study.
Well, you know, it's not too much. I mean, really, generators are just motors operating in reverse. You know that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what they are. You can take a regular old electric motor, operate it, if you can make it run in reverse, you can generate electricity.
I have one other question I've wondered for 20 years.
What's that?
What do ham radio people talk about when they actually get into the
hobby? Well, you know, it's not something that I can generally speak of. You know, the main talk occurs after the secret handshake.
I'm not sure what that is, sir.
It's, well, it's secret. No, I'm just... You mean, what do hams talk about when they're on the air?
Yeah, they like the CB. Like, you know, when I was growing up, I used to play with my granddad CB. And, you know, it was... Yeah, I mean,
there was a day, my friend, when I would have bristled, double-tapped you, and thrown you off my phone for saying something like that. But, increasingly, I'm sad to say, ham radio doesn't exactly sound like CB, but it's more like CB than it used to be, and I'm hating it. Does that answer your question?
Kind of. I've actually never heard of that. I've got a cheap shortwave radio, but it's kind of it's not ham for sure.
Have you listened to us on 5085?
Will those cheap shortwave radios pick that up?
Of course they will. And now let me mention it to everybody else while I'm at it. We are on shortwave. Did you know that? 5.085, and you will hear us. And I am actually, let me tell you something, I'm quite shocked at how many people are listening on shortwave. It is astounding. I thought most of the shortwave listeners out there sort of gave up because, frankly, there wasn't much interesting on shortwave. I'm talking about commercial broadcasting now. So many of them have quit. It's very expensive. But we are on shortwave, and so many people have found us. And so you can be one of those. If you happen to have a hand crank radio, a shortwave radio, 5.085, every night live. Hello there in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma.
Hello, Art.
Hi.
I'm not exactly a prepper, but I am an amateur radio operator.
All right.
And I think if you've been a ham forever and ever like I have, back in the 70s I first got licensed, a lot of your attention goes to, well, how would I be ready to do this if, you know, we had something that, you know, if there's a disaster, and
yes,
I've helped out after a disaster, and we have the tornadoes here in Oklahoma City area, and after the May 3rd, 1999 tornadoes, I spent a couple of weeks helping the Red Cross do radio communication.
Uh-huh.
But we think about, you know, what would I do to get up an antenna? What band would I need an antenna up for?
You would.
Yes. What do I do to keep my battery charged? You know, not just have a battery, but how am I going to keep it charged for a while? What about if gasoline runs out? You know, how do we keep it charged? You know, you think about a lot of things like that have a bearing on how we would continue to do these things if we had something that, you know, a disaster. But
it's actually pretty scary, sir, contemplating how thin the line of civilization really is. In other words, how little disruption it really would take to make people go completely berserk. They're halfway there now.
Yes, and, you know, if we're not producing electricity, then we can't pump gasoline out of the ground to fuel our generators.
That's right.
So, you know, it begins to get complicated very fast, and we don't have the transportation to distribute the things that we need. And, you know, there are a lot of things that could go wrong.
These are reasons why you have to watch educational shows like The Walking Dead.
Yes. Yes, because, you know, we've got all these scenarios to play out there. Yeah, I've been doing this since I was a little kid. I was 10 years old when I first started getting really interested in radio, and got my parents to buy me a couple of walkie-talkies for Christmas one year. And
You want to hear something really wild? You know, kids weren't getting into this sort of thing for a long, long time. Heathkit. Remember Heathkit? It just came back. There are actually Heathkits for sale again. So mommy and daddy can get their child a Heathkit, and they can build a radio, receiver, or transmitter. Is that cool or what? Jerry on Skype, you're on the air.
Yes, Art, I'm not a prepper, but I am a time traveler.
You are?
Yes, I am. I love it. I listen to you every day in the morning.
Oh, you mean that kind of time traveler, not the real travel like to 2048 type time traveler? Or is that what you're saying?
No, I am a Art Bell time traveler.
Okay, so you get to hear our show when you want to. Isn't it nice?
It's even better than the real thing.
Yeah.
As far as time traveling, not better than you, but... Now, I'm not a prepper, but I was a hospital corpsman with the Marines.
Yes.
In Iraq, in the front lines. And it's funny that you mentioned the zombie show. What's the name of that show?
Walking Dead.
The Walking Dead.
Yeah.
Because when I was over there, and we're talking when there's no government, no police officers, the civilization is completely gone, the infrastructure, then everybody becomes like a zombie. What I mean is, you have your neighbors, they want what you have.
Yeah.
Everybody around wants what you have, and they're everybody stealing in herds. It's
I totally get
worse
it.
Than anything that would ever happen on The Walking Dead.
Yeah, there's a lot of things I miss out. I mean, for example, on The Walking Dead, you don't see people scrounging for gas. They find cars that are already filled with gas, and it's now been presumably years since the whole thing happened. But they, you know, find cars with the gas.
You'd see about 20 people in the back of one truck. But Art, I had another story I wanted to tell you.
Sure.
If you don't mind, real quick. This one is kind of a scary story.
Okay, well, we're coming up on a break here. So.
It's a good one.
It is?
It is.
I wouldn't be sorry if I held you over during the break.
You would not.
You would scare everybody?
It is a good one, and it is true.
A good one, and it's true. Well, you can't beat that. All right, then. You are certified as a holdover. Stay right where you are. We'll be right back. I expect big things from you, sir. Jerry, your name is. We'll get back to you after the break. From the high desert, this is Midnight in the Desert.
Take a ride from the high desert and the great American Southwest. This is Midnight in the Desert, exclusively on the Dark Matter Digital Network. To call the show, dial 1-952-CALL-ART. That's 1-952-225-5278.
Well, all right. I'm going to do something at the end of this hour that I haven't done in years and years and years, and just see how it goes. I'm going to do something called Fast Blast. Maybe the last 10 minutes of the show, something like that. And what I'm going to do is it will involve all the phone numbers that I've got only. I'm not going to do it on Skype. We're going to do it only on the phone lines. And I'm going to allow people to say, like, 10 or 15 seconds of something really cool or whatever they feel like saying. And I'm just going to go boom, 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 boom through the line. So this would be your chance to get through and get something on. So here are the numbers I'm going to be using. Public line, area code 952-225-5278. You will get through if I do it this way. Area code 952-225-5278. The prepper line can be used as well. That's area code 575-208-7787. Write one of these down. Area code 575-208-7787. 7787, and finally, the first-time caller line. You can even use that when we're in Fast Blast. That's area code 775-285-5800. 775-285-5800. So what I'll do is I'll just take as many calls as I can possibly take in, say, a, I don't know, 5 or 10 minute period. We'll just blast away and let you get at least a thought out on the air. Now, back to Jerry. Jerry has told us he is going to scare us. So, Jerry, live up to the brag.
Yes, sir. It was a dark night just like this. It was the same time of year. I lived in a small town called Childress, Texas. And I worked at a gas station called Citgo. And it was about midnight. And I was stocking the cigarettes. I heard the ding ding and I looked up and I saw the door open, and it was, I don't know, about a late 40s looking Italian man. Mm. He had really dark hair, but it was starting to salt on the sides.
Okay.
And he had a really nice suit on. And I just barely saw him. You know, I saw that he walked in. I saw he's walking over there towards the coffee. I was putting up more cigarettes, and I looked up, and he had the coffee pot, and it was scalding hot. I just made fresh coffee, Art. And he had it turned up to his lips, and he was drinking it like it was ice-cold water.
Wow.
And I was frozen when I saw that. And he looked at me dead in the eyes, and his eyes were completely black. And I was froze as soon as I could. I looked away.
Yeah, I'm giving it to you already. This is scary stuff. So you're sure it was scalding hot coffee just made?
I had just made it before I walked right over to the counter and put the cigarettes up.
Oh, man.
Just made it.
All right. So what did he do? Just turn around and walk out? Or did he come over and say, listen, I really needed that coffee hot, and then paid you, or how did this resolve?
I was froze. I looked at him. He looked me right in the eyes, and he had nothing but blackness, just black eyes, no whites.
Mm-hmm.
Then he walked right out that door, got in his car, and drove away.
Yeah, did he down the whole pot?
He downed the whole big pot, just like it was cold water.
Oh, man, what a story.
I ran out there. I was going to ask him if he's going to pay for that coffee. Then I realized, what am I doing?
That's right.
I went back inside. I was scared. And, Art, I called my mom.
You called your mom?
I called my mom. She came down there. We started reading the Bible and praying all night long till the sun came up.
Really?
Yes.
Well, I guess most people do that. They'd call mom. Why not?
Scary.
Yeah, I understand. And I understand calling mom, too. Thank you very much for the call. It's hard to envision somebody, can you imagine that? Somebody grabbing a scalding hot cup or, you know, what would you call it? I guess a 10 cups, 12 cups would hold. And just downing it right in front of you? A pot that big? All right. Let's go to Summerfield, I think, on the phones. Hello? Summerfield? Hello? Illinois, I think. Going once. Going twice. Aw. Waiting all that time, you're not going to talk, really? I can hear you breathing. Oh, well. Waynesville, I think, North Carolina.
Art, this is David in North Carolina.
I'm sorry, who?
This is David in North Carolina, Art.
David, okay.
In the Smoky Mountains of North Carolina, called on the prepper line. How are you tonight?
I'm just fine. Are you a prepper?
I am on prepper round two. Used to be a Florida resident, quit my job of 26 years and moved on to my sailboat. And after a year of that, I very quickly decided that sailboat living is not the way to be a prepper. So sailboats are very, very much tied to the land. And so now I'm on round two. I've moved to the mountains of North Carolina.
So you went from the water to the mountains?
I went from the water to the mountains.
I think the most important question is, what are you prepping for? What do you expect will cause this need?
Well, it's not so much a need, Art, as that as a society, we're losing our ability to function without technology. Most people, if they were put in a situation where they had to get their own food and fend for themselves, dead in a week, easily dead in a week.
Dead in a week.
And that's my assumption.
I really hate to agree with you, but I honestly think I do. I read a thing from a university professor, I believe he was, the other night, in which he said that people don't see UFOs as sentient. He said this much better than I'm about to, because we don't ever look up from the device we're staring at in front of us.
That is the worst thing that I see around me. And you know, I got to say, I was one of those people. I was an early adopter of the smartphone.
Right.
And it wasn't very long before you looked around and you're sitting at a bar with your friends or having dinner with your friends.
Yep, I know.
And you weren't. You're having dinner with everyone's smartphone.
I know, sir. And I'm guilty of it myself. If I, for example, I can go up the street to a casino we have where they serve great dinner and... you know, if they're filled up, you've got to wait by a little fireplace. And so there's, you know, I don't know, 8 or 10 people sitting around the fireplace, all waiting for their name to be called, all staring right into their phones and not looking at each other. So you're dead right. And by the way, sir, I'm one of those people.
Oh, Art, I hope you overcome it.
It's got me, sir. I'm serious about that. Actually, it does. I mean, I am hooked on my iPhone. I hate to admit it, but I'm as hooked on it as any drug that you'd get hooked on.
It can be overcome, Art. Let me tell you, it can be overcome. It's hard.
And life can go on.
You just got to disconnect from it and find something else that catches your interest. And might I suggest, you know, I heard you say that ham radio's become... more and more like CB radio has.
Well, that guy said it. I sort of agreed with him. Not in every case. It's still way above, but, boy, I'll tell you.
I also heard you say CW was dead. Give it another try, Art.
Well, I didn't say dead. It's not dead, and I still do CW to myself, sir. So it's not dead. I love CW, but it's not required any longer to become a ham operator, which is really a shame.
It is a shame, and I'm a new ham, only since last March, and I spent my first 3 months on CW, and all the time since getting much better at it.
All right. Thank you so very much for the call. I'm going to take one more quick Skype call here, then I'm going to do a fast blast. Hello.
Hi there, Art.
Hi.
Yeah, just wanted to make a quick comment before you go on the blast there on the phones. I've been hearing for months and months now, at least once a week, somebody calls in and says something about we're having a population problem. There's too many people in the world, et cetera, et cetera. But just like you said, you don't believe that there's a gun problem in America. There's a mental health problem.
I do.
I don't think there's a population problem. I think there's a management problem. Because I'm calling from Canada. I'm one of the rare breeds up there. And we got a little island called Prince Edward Island. It's 6 billion square meters in size.
Right.
Which means 10 years ago, everybody in the world could have stood comfortably on that island. Now, sure, that's not taking in resources and stuff, but it kind of gives you a bit of an eye visual of just how big this world really is. And I think people that are saying that there's a population problem are probably the first ones to be up against the wall if there really was a population issue and the culling started.
The culling. What a word, culling. Yes, well, you could be correct, sir. I appreciate it. Thank you for calling. And
all right, have a good night, Art.
Yeah, you call again. For sure. All right, let's do it. I'm just going to take some very quick calls. So you, here's the deal. Once again, you've got the numbers, right? So if I answer the phone, give me about 10 seconds of the most important thing on your mind. And we'll just go through it. Okay, here we go. You're on the air.
God bless Ted Gunderson.
Okay, thank you very much. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Am I?
Yes, you're on the air. When I say you're on the air, that's what it means. Go ahead.
Good enough. I'm just thinking, my concern is right now, this whole thing with Syria, I think we're getting overheated with the idea of refugees. I want to make it one simple point. The refugees that we're taking in have already been pretty much been encapsulated or held in the encampments in Jordan.
All right, I've got to run. Thank you. It's fast stuff we're doing here. You're on the air. Going
hello?
Once. Yes, hello.
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 World, rock on. Rock on and peace out.
All right, thanks. Hi, you're on the air.
Hey, Pepper T here. Just wanted to tell you, Faraday cage, solar power, wind power, charge them batteries up when the grid goes down. And I want to tell you what else. The culling has already started. Peace out, brother. I love you, man.
Thanks. Bye. Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, Art, Roswells.
Thank you.
Hi, my call sign is AJ6.
No, don't give your call on the air.
Okay, sir. Okay, just real quick, reloading is a great hobby. I'm looking at like three reloaders right now, a Dillon RL550B and a SL900. So
okay.
People will get into reloading.
All right, thank you. You're on the air. Hello.
Hey, this is Josh. God bless you, world, and Art. I love you. I'm so glad you're back on the air.
Good to have you, sir. Thank you. Hello, you're on the air.
Yes. Hello, Art.
Hi.
How are you tonight?
Just fine. Real quick now, something.
Yeah, I'm sounding a little sluggish because I had to take my medication due to my recent time travel missions.
Oh, well, you're going to have to call me back on the show and tell me all about it. Hello, you're on the air in Ketchikan, Alaska.
For immunization, Senate bill just passed a bill making veterans mandatory for forced immunizations. Have you heard of that one?
Forced immunizations? No, I haven't. Not for vets. Vancouver, you're on the air. Hi. Going once, going twice, gone.
Yeah, oh, no.
Uh-oh. Sorry. You got to be there when I come to the phone. Hello.
I'm trying to be.
Go. Go. Talk.
Hello. Okay, yeah, hi. I just want to say that you should listen to the music of Stan Ridgway and consider putting some of it on for bumper music.
Yeah,
it would be absolutely
it.
Perfect.
All right, thank you. You're on the air. Hello.
Hello, Mr. Art Bell.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Art Bell, I just want to say this to the world.
Yes?
Let's start listening from our heart and stop listening directly from our ears. Our heart knows. Listen from your heart to everybody. Thank you, Abel.
Thank you. Take care. You're on the air. Hello.
Art Beal, as I sit here in Dallas, Texas, the nation state will rise again.
I love that accent. Hi, you're on the air.
Hi, Art.
Hello.
Hi, I just wanted to say that Bernie Sanders needs to be taken really seriously in this election. I think that he could hedge fund revolution.
Well, we'll find out. You're on the air. Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, I just want people to remember there's lots of homeless people out right now in Vancouver. It's below freezing. It doesn't hurt to go down and bring a sweater and some or sleeping bag or something and give them a hug or just make sure that they're noticed.
Good message. Thank you. On the air. Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
All right.
Yes.
Hey, this is Les. I just want to say to encourage everybody to go to hashtag DM Talk and meet all your hardcore listeners there.
All right. Thank you. Hi, you're on the air.
Hi, it's the evil Keith. I just want to warn you what I put in your closet last night.
Yeah. Evil Keith. Las Vegas, you're on the air.
Yes, I love the fact that you're back on the air. I've been listening to you since the Ross Perot days. On KDON Radio, and I'm actually a first-time caller.
That's a long time ago, brother.
Just wanted to say I talked to Art Bell on the radio.
You did indeed. Thank you. Hi, you're on the air.
Oh, hi. I think people are just overly stressed, and I think we should go to a four-day work week. And I also want to wish my cousins, American cousins, a happy Thanksgiving.
Okay, I'm good with the four-day work week thing. Hello there. You're on the air. Going once.
Art.
Yes.
Hey, Art.
Yes.
Just wanted to call and say that I got to talk to Art Bell.
You
did. So glad you came back on the air.
Thank you, brother.
Absolutely great. 15-year listener.
Thank you for calling. And you're on the air. Hello.
Let's make America great again. That's it. Boom.
Yeah, I'm all for that. Thank you. You're on the air. Hello.
Hi. Whatever happened to the 3840 group?
They still exist, but it just ain't the same old crowd, sir. Thank you. Hi. You're on the air.
Hey, Art. I just want to say that if people are prepped for zombies, they're prepped for anything. So
that's a fact. Boy, that's a fact. Hi. You're on the air. Going once, going twice, going three times, you're on the air.
Hi, my name is George, the truck driver, and I want to win the lottery.
Are you in a truck right now? George? I guess you're not. Okay, that was fast. You're on the air. Hello?
Red Martian is coming. Red Martian is coming. Red Martian is coming.
Yeah. You're on the air. Hello?
Down with Hoagie.
Hi, you're on the air.
Everybody pray for next week. Art, there's going to be a major terrorist attack next week.
Oh, God. You're on the air. Hello?
There's a troop of cops under my bed.
There probably is. Enjoy it. You're on the air. Hello?
Hello?
No. Hello? You're on the air.
Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, I don't want to hear any more about preppers. I think we've heard enough about them. Honestly.
Be smart. Don't prep. No problem. Hello, you're on the air.
Nobody puts baby in a corner.
Hello, you're on the air. Hello? Hello, you're on the air.
Hey, I wanted to let everybody know about lemonparty.org. It's a creative solution to the refugee problem.
All right. Thank you. All right, listen. Whoa, wait. Are you still there?
I'm still here.
All right, I'm out of time. We're really out of time. So, say, for all the time zones out there, good night, world.
For all the time zones out there, good night, world.
That's the way to do it. Good night in the desert. That's all the time we have. Good night. This was done in the air. I've been looking for the answers. All my life I felt you there. As the world we live in, are we heeding all the signs? Have we lost our interest?